Good morning. The 13th century mystic Meister Eckhart said that if the only prayer you ever say in your entire life is thank you, it will be enough. So thank you. With those words, let me begin with gratitude and say on behalf of Steve, Carlene, and myself, how grateful I am to know that you are watching this morning, wherever you are on this beautiful July day. As physically distant as we remain, it feels so reassuring to get your emails, your phone calls, and notes, even seeing some of you taking a walk past Lime Street or meeting together in a small book group on our front lawn. The power of presence, even from afar, seems more vital and necessary than ever. So thank you. Thank you for taking care of us, of our community, so very well in these challenging days. And please let us know if you do have a lingering need. We are here and would love to talk with you and connect. Our staff and ministers are working very hard, even though our building is officially closed to the public. Your collective spirit is alive and well in the world. Our missions and ministries continue day in and day out, thanks to your ongoing generosity and support of our partnerships and compassionate work that we are doing together. Now, today, I am delighted to welcome the Reverend Kathy Zoll, Executive Director of the Homeless Hospitality Center in New London. She is our preacher for today. And as you probably know, Kathy was an associate minister here for 5 years. She left in 2012 to begin the Homeless Hospitality Center, and we are very grateful for her friendship and for this ongoing partnership. And Kathy, for all the ways you and your staff, the volunteers, and guests remind us of the gospel mandate to love one another in action. And during this pandemic, the redoubled efforts that you've made to house the ill and continue to house the homeless during this COVID crisis, it has been nothing short of miraculous and inspiring to all of us. I also want to offer thanks to our missions board and Our Lady's Benevolent Society, for they have sent thousands of dollars from our budget to the Homeless Hospitality Center. So thank you for your continued and sustaining support. Now, by way of announcements, our Zoom coffee hour will happen today, Sunday at 10 a.m. and the invitation is on our website, so I hope you'll join us. Activities for the coming week are there as well, and please note that our next Racial Justice Book Group on the Lawn meets August 6th at 7 p.m. We will make small circles depending on how many of you come, and we will be social distancing, wearing masks, and so forth. We'll be discussing How to Be an Anti-Racist by Ibram Kendi. This is our second book in a series of three. Now, I'd like to thank our worship team for today's service, especially our director and of music and organist, Simon Holt, our soloist, Lisa Feltis, and our scripture reader today is Fred Berenger. As always, special thanks to our office manager, video editor, Odile Brennan, and our tireless communications director, John Kiker, who is working nearly every day on our web communications. And let me not forget the one and only Mary Tomasetti for her filming today. Also, I want to offer thanks to some of our confirmation students, Mariam Kazadi, Maverick Swaney, and Grace Arnold, for their assistance this morning in bringing our outdoor display indoors. You may have noticed during the prelude this morning that we've taken down the black banners from the front and side of our meeting house, as well as the doors of hope, and that were placed on our front lawn as a visual response to the death of George Floyd and the horrors of racism. Some of that display is part of our service this morning as we mark the close of our mourning and bless the path of commitment ahead. With God's grace, let us forge together a path to ongoing change and justice as we respond to the needs of the world. And now I'd like to invite Mariam Kazadi up to offer our opening invocation.
Friends, let us pray. Loving God, thank you for living and loving in us and through us. May all that we do flow from our deep connection with the Holy in water form. Help us to keep growing as a community that share each other hardship and joy with compassion and grace. Listen to our heart longing. May our faith continue to move us to seek justice, live mercy, and walk humbly with you for the healing of all this day. Amen.
And now please join me in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, gather us in during this time of prayer with arms wide open to the needs and dreams of all. May our collective prayers and silence be a blessing on this beautiful summer morning. May these baskets, filled with the beloved names of those murdered, of the quotes and the prayers, demands, and dreams that the community has written, may they be as a balm in Gilead, as a beacon for a way forward. May our commitment now to dismantle racism grow bolder and bolder. Lighten our spirits, enliven our hearts as we build up courage for the work of the beloved community set before us. Remind us again of the psalmist's prayer that weeping may last for the night, but joy shall come in the morning. We give thanks this week for the legacy of so many justice giants leading the way to change in these fraught days. May the spirit of John Lewis and C.T. Vivian continue to inspire the work that we are called to join in for civil rights, our human rights. We give thanks to the young leaders in our community and across this country, making a way forward in the name of justice and equality. Help us to listen and learn from one another. We give thanks too for the newly formed Wall of Mothers in Portland and elsewhere, for the ways they are protecting protesters. We pray for our neighbors near and far, afflicted by the unrelenting pandemics of COVID and racism, for those especially vulnerable to the disease, and all those health workers selflessly giving of themselves. We pray for children, children in harm's way today, and those who are seeking solace and shelter, for the displaced and those fleeing violence. We pray for refugees, for those in prison, those in detention centers. We bless the organizations and the leaders, the physicians, the volunteers, the peacekeepers who work for justice in hot spots all over the world. We pray also today for the partnerships of our beloved church that connect us to this wide world, from South Africa to Palestine, from Haiti to Greengrass, South Dakota, from Old Lyme to New London and beyond. Keep widening our vision, O God, and bless us with these friendships. Open us up to your divine spirit and the way new partnerships may arise as the wheels of justice keep moving us along. We offer prayers for all educators, administrators, parents, and grandparents, all those strategizing for the coming school year. May their discernment lead to wise decision-making and equanimity. We pray for those struggling to pay for their bills, those out of work on furlough, those guests coming on Saturday mornings to our food pantry, and those in need of respite. We pray for those hungry and hurt, those with ongoing needs invisible to the world, those in danger of eviction, and all who help offer dignity and respite. Lord, we are living with such uncertainty. Help us to count these days with whole and generous hearts. We give thanks for our community. And as the psalmist reminds us, each person is wonderfully and fearfully made and precious in your sight. In all ways, in the name of love, we pray together. Amen.
Well, good morning. Let me quickly interject that I miss you all, and I hope that everyone has been safe. Before beginning today's scripture reading, I've been asked to say a few words about the Homeless Hospitality Center. As you've probably seen, Kathy Zoll will be providing the sermon this morning. For many of the Wednesdays over the past 5 years, I've driven into New London to help with the check-in at the center. And there are many things I could tell you about my experience there over the years. For one, the New London Homeless Hospitality Center is a tremendous service to the community and to people who are homeless. The clients there are treated with grace and dignity and compassion, and no doubt that tone is set by Kathy Zoll. And the love and the compassion that are shown the guests there, I'm sure, goes a long way to helping people regain their footing in life. I've also been in awe of the staff at the center. Now, many of the guests are very pleasant to interact with, even delightful, but there are a few that are more problematic and even trying at times. But I've never seen the staff lose their cool, and they treat everyone with the utmost respect. And that, I believe, also sends a very powerful message. Personally, the experience has been very rich for me, and I'll just mention a couple things. One thing is I enjoy going into a community that is very different from Old Lyme. And probably most importantly, the experience has taught me to be more humble and compassionate. So with that, I'd like to go to today's reading, which is from the Book of Psalms. And it's Psalm 139, 1 through 12. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you, and the night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. So ends the reading for today.
Good morning. As many of you know, this is a very special place for me, this meeting house. Over 25 years ago, when my family moved to Lyme, I ended up here at FCCOL, and over time, I was blessed with preaching and study and service, especially at Koinonia, that helped me literally fall in love with Jesus. And through Jesus, helped me get a glimpse into the bigger mystery we call Christ. So when I get the chance to preach here now, so many years after that first visit, I feel drawn back into the deep roots of faith, feel compelled to think about the foundational ideas, try to reflect on what matters the most about this journey we call the spiritual path. The faith journey is, I think, infinitely complicated and mysterious, but also in a way surprisingly simple at its core. So what is at the heart of the life of faith? One word is often used, and that is love. And that's true enough. But the word love has become so sentimentalized that we need to supplement it with other words that point to the same reality. And one of those words that I've come to love from Scripture, which is used to describe the fundamental character of God, is righteousness. Now, not righteousness as we sometimes think of it today, such as self-righteousness, but biblical righteousness, which is a deeply nuanced word that seeks to name God's shalom-building action in the world. At the heart of righteousness is the quest for shalom, which means bringing all the parts of the web of creation into right relationship. Relationships of mutual care, relationships of peace, relationships that bring life. Righteousness is God's active participation in the world. Righteousness is not something God has, but something God does. Righteousness is not a static noun, but an active verb. Righteousness is what Martin Luther King described as active, unconditional goodwill. Righteousness is not a sentiment or a feeling, but a way of being. So at the heart, at the foundation of the spiritual journey is, I believe, the call for every one of us to take up the same work of righteousness, manifest this same love in the world. A call for every one of us to be part of God's shalom-building action in the world. A call for every one of us to be active agents of love. A call for every one of us to experience ourselves as part of God's great unfolding passion for a world of justice and peace. Now, for me, a faith tradition is one vehicle that seeks to equip us to answer that call. Not the only one, of course. Nature and silence and relationships and many other things also call us. But I think we gather as a Christian faith community because we find in Scripture, in the example of Jesus, a vehicle that can equip us, lead us, support us in becoming agents of God's unconditional love. Help us become active builders of shalom. So in sermons each week, we take one small piece of this vast tapestry of Scripture and turn it around in our minds to see what it might tell us about God's righteousness, to explore what it might tell us about what it might mean to act with love, what insights it gives us into the process of building shalom. Now, when I first started in ministry and had the chance to speak, to preach, I would spend hours looking for the right scripture to match the point I wanted to make. But quite a while ago, I changed my process. Now, I simply look at the scriptures assigned by the common lectionary for any particular day of the year I have the chance to preach, and I choose one of them. So this process is what led me to our text from Psalm 139 today. Now, Scripture is holy because it's alive. It speaks.
Of course, it speaks about its own time, but also, I think, to our time, and more specifically, to each of our individual lives. God is still speaking in many ways, but one of them, for me, is through Scripture. The goal, I think, is to open ourselves up to what is being said. Not to hold Scripture at arm's length for academic study, but to let whatever it has to say be in deep conversation with our lives and shape us to participate in God's work in the world. So this morning I want to share a bit of what I heard when I immersed myself in this beautiful passage from Psalm 139. What I hear most deeply is a description of the author's experience of key aspects of God's righteousness. And I hear two particular themes. First, God's shalom building action in the world is at once universal and deeply personal. God is deeply entwined in the specifics of creation. God's action and love is for creation as a whole, but also somehow uniquely and specially expressed in ways that recognize that each one of us has our own personal uniqueness. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my paths and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. We are not interchangeable cogs in a giant machine, but unique, seen, valued, and known in our individual particularities. Second, God's shalom building action is always at work. We cannot be separated from it, by distance, or most importantly, by our actions. Whether we put ourselves in heaven or in hell, God's active love is there. If we embrace it or we run away from it, God's active love is there. If our lives are overwhelmed with darkness of any sort, God's active love is still there. If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the furthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. God's shalom-building action begins with a deep knowing of the uniqueness of every fragment of creation. God's shalom-building work has a unitary goal, but plays out in ways that respect and even celebrate the uniqueness of every particle of creation. God's righteousness is not a one-size-fits-all, take-it-or-leave-it, imposed solution, but a customized invitation to wholeness. God's shalom-building action is not rationed based on worth, but poured out lavishly and unconditionally on all of creation in all its various states of order and disarray. Now, neither of these insights into God's action in the world is unique to the author of Psalm 139. We see this same insight over and over throughout the Hebrew Scriptures, the Gospels, and very clearly in Paul's most moving letters. But here's the key. Are we willing and able to act upon what we hear Scripture saying? Does what we hear make any difference in our lives? What the world needs now, I propose, is people who are willing to hear this understanding of righteousness and actively take up the task of partnering in God's work to shape the world towards shalom. Now, this is hard. The way we have been shaped by our culture and the needs of our own fragile egos make it a challenge to claim our identity as being made in God's image, make it hard to pay attention to the Christ within each of our hearts, hard to take this vision of shalom seriously, hard to dare to even imagine that we have a critical part to play in God's shalom building work. And I'd like to share an example of a way that I'm grappling with this right now. As many of you know, for many years now, I have been working at the Homeless Hospitality Center. And as Laura mentioned, this church community has been instrumental in making our work possible. Now, after all these years, I thought I had a pretty good understanding of what this work was all about. I was quite confident that we were approaching the work of addressing homelessness in the most appropriate way. But about a year ago, I encountered a book called Radical Health that gave me a new way of seeing what we were doing. Helped me see how while we were doing many good things, we had allowed our work to be shaped by the logic of the factory rather than shalom building framework revealed by our text and so much of scripture. Radical Health allowed me to see how we profoundly and much of our social service system had stopped being about putting the person in the center as a unique individual and had instead become increasing like an assembly line that doled out a set of well-intentioned but standardized services. We, in addressing homelessness, but also in healthcare and many other services, had adopted the model of the factory and abandoned the shalom building model of scripture. While our religious imagination called us to search, to seek and know people as individuals, to take this time to discern the thoughts of those we served, to be willing to search out each person's unique path, to be curious about the bigger picture of all a person's diverse ways, across the social service landscape, we had transferred our focus from people to our services. Our interactions with people in need became increasingly transactional. As Radical Help says, our focus has become managing, handling, treating, and transferring. People in need, pushing people in need across some kind of standardized assembly line of predefined services. We had designed well-intentioned systems where poor people needed to fit in rather than flexible supports that were designed to respond to people as individuals. We turned people from unique individuals we needed to get to know into customers for services and products we designed. While our religious imagination would say, if I take the wings of the morning and settle at the furthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me fast. Too often our systems were saying, no traveling to the furthest limits of the sea. If you want anything from us, you have to do it our way, on our timetable. We focused on fixing problems, but left too little room for supporting dreams. Our systems are often quick to drop the non-compliant individual rather than offering a right hand that would hold them fast. Our religious imagination says, if I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light around me become night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Our systems, on the other hand, are too often quick to abandon people when they entered the darkness of substance use disorders or mental health challenges or anger or alienation. We too often lost the ability to see the light within that darkness. Even as we fell into these traps, we did help people, and we continue to need well-designed and effectively delivered services. But this book forced me to examine the assumptions and the visions that shape our work. This analysis opened my eyes to see the profound difference between the imagination of the factory and the imagination of God's shalom building way of engaging creation. And once I saw, I have started the hard work of exploring how we can keep doing what's effective, but also change to more fully reflect the shalom-building approach that so much of Scripture points to as the path to life for all of creation. Now, this is not the place to unpack all the ways I hope we can change. What I simply want to highlight is my increasing conviction that what the world needs so desperately now is people willing to take Scripture's understanding of God's righteousness, take the teachings of Jesus, the Spirit of Christ, and bring it, however imperfectly, into our lives. The specifics will differ in each case. The shalom building actions that will be appropriate will differ based on our particular circumstances. There are so many places, though: healthcare, the environment, our political dialogue, or lack of it, poverty, the growing crisis of loneliness, and so much more, where we need responses informed not by the logic of the factory or the marketplace, but by the logic of shalom building. I have come to believe that God's righteousness is expressed in the world through unlimited, unconditional invitation. God's passion is shalom, but it will not be imposed on creation by force. God can make all things new, but it will not happen without our cooperation. We will need to collectively choose life. Can this happen? I am at the same time highly alarmed and somewhat hopeful. Alarmed that we are in so many ways choosing death, but hopeful because the door is always open and we can still collectively choose life. I am hopeful because the capacity to hear God's invitation and the power to partner with God in turning that invitation into reality is present in every one of us. I am alarmed by how little we seem to be listening to that invitation. I am alarmed as I look around and see the many ways we have gotten way off track, but hopeful because I am confident that deep in our hearts we know the way. What the world needs now, I think, is people committed to finding the wisdom, will, and courage to turn what we hear in our hearts into the work of our hands. What the world needs now is a reinvigorated imagination that can replace the logic of the marketplace with the seemingly unlikely logic of shalom building. But maybe to say it as simply as possible, what the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love, not just for some, but for everyone. With God's help, may we each be ever more committed and effective agents of that love. Amen. Thank you. now and are going, may God bless us and keep us. May the light of God shine upon us and out from within us. Be gracious unto us and grant us peace. For this is the day we are given. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.